Hello, and welcome to the Concept Artist Podcast, interviewing up-and-coming concept artists to learn what it's like entering the industry today. Coco Lynge is an intern artist currently working at the Danish visual development studio Mood. They have an incredibly impressive portfolio that is wide-reaching in style, from more stylistic to realism. They also have worked as a children's book illustrator and recently became a member of Danske Forfatning, aka the Danish Writing Association. Welcome to the show, Coco.
Oh, hi. Thank you for inviting me. It was really nice of you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
All right. So first question, just to kind of set the tone, what is a concept artist by your definition? And how would you say it's different from an illustrator or a matte painter?
So the way that I actually have to answer this question for family members who have no idea what it actually means to be a concept artist or what it actually is, I just tell them that, like, yeah, but you always just get those questions at family gatherings.
Oh, yeah.
Because they have no idea what it means or what it is, what you're actually doing. Mm-hmm. I just tell them that as my job or in my internship, I'm iterating a ton of ideas, drawing them out before they actually go through the pipeline in games or films to new final products or costumes. So it's just all the drawing parts beforehand that gets either greenlit or ditched. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
So it's not a bunch of, so you paint, right?
They do ask me that sometimes. It depends on what job you're doing, because if you're in the first stages, you're just sketching out and thumbnailing a ton of ideas. Some of those ideas might get approved, and then you have to go into different stages of further iterating on that one or two idea. And then to the last stage, where you have to kind of going into illustration and refining the designs that you're making, painting them or photobashing them. Photobashing, where you actually have to find a ton of images. It's very tedious, but you have to find a ton of images and put them together to show the textures, the materials that you're putting into your costume design, for example.
So to kind of further build on that for people that may not have a full grasp of what that is, would you define photo bashing as kind of finding reference for your pieces, or would that be something you would build off of in the beginning stages?
Finding references would be something that you do in the beginning of your ideation and thumbnailing. That's where you find all your ideas. When you're photo bashing, you're more trying to explain the design to the smallest details. Sometimes you have to find other photos that matches or partially matches, because you can also do some paint over of the small details that you want in there. It's very tedious, to say the least.
I can imagine.
Yeah. Especially when you really want to just sit and paint.
Yes, definitely. When it comes to this part of the pipeline, where do you find the most valuable feedback for improving your art? Do you find it within your team in the internship? Or do you have an online community that you prefer to turn to?
In my internship, I do get most of my feedback from the concept artist who actually oversees me or supports me. I give them a lot of questions, they answer, they look through my designs and give me feedback on it. And then there's also the client feedback. That's in general like something that we also get to see and interact with. So we understand what the client wants and what they don't want.
Always important.
Yes, very important.
And do you have kind of an online community that you also go to for feedback, or is the internship more of your main focus for improving your art?
Currently, it actually is my internship and the people who work at the studio that I get a lot of feedback from. Other people that I do use for feedback and inspiration are my classmates currently, who are also in internships. So they are busy most of the time, but they do find time and are really sweet people who wants to help you, or at least the people they go to class with, right?
That's always good.
But I don't have any online places where I actually get feedback. I try not to do that. I think it's merely a preference that I want feedback from people I know and who I know are really capable and skilled at what they do. So I always go to the person that I find have the skill set that I want to acquire information from, right?
Definitely. That makes sense.
Yeah.
So when it comes to building up and really using that feedback and using your skills, when about did you start focusing on building your portfolio from that? And what would you say is your process for building up portfolio pieces that you deem as, yes, this is good enough to put in a portfolio?
I actually started focusing on my portfolio when I got into the first year of my education at the animation workshop. I made a website, look at some layouts that I really liked and put in some artwork and try to have fresh eyes on my online portfolio and try to analyze if what I do present on my website or my online portfolio is what represents me the best and what I want to do in the future. And currently it's more like character concepting, and it is a wide variety of styles that I try to show, because you have to show that you're capable, but you also have to find the sweet spot of you trying to specialize some places. Some people really like to do props, others do costumes a lot. Other people are really, really, really good at world building, which is like a big feat in itself, because it's so many things and details that you have to think out beforehand.
Oh yeah, that's almost combining several of those things. That's combining environments, props.
Yes, it is.
So you said that you started really doing that when you were in your first year of that.
Yes.
So how old were you when you entered the industry?
Right now, as an intern, I am 30. So I'm actually a very late bloomer in concepting. Most of my classmates are quite a lot younger than I am, but also had quite the journey before I actually got into the animation workshop, because I've really, really been determined on getting into the animation workshop for five, six years before I actually got in, because there are so many applicants, it's international, all the education is in English, and to me it was also just to stay in Denmark.
Well, congratulations then. That definitely is a feat, so you should be really proud of that.
Yeah, thank you. It's been quite a struggle too.
So when you started your internship, what did you have in your portfolio at the time?
Actually, everything that you see on my portfolio now is what I have, except for one piece. I haven't had the time to update my portfolio at all or make new pieces for it, because it's just been a lot of like stress with COVID or finding internship and working. I've been doing some book illustration next to my education while I was doing my third year film on a project that was like, I think it was 8 or 9 months long. So it was just a lot of things that has prevented me from making any new pieces.
Yeah, I've seen that has kind of been a very universal thing for all sorts of artists these past couple years with COVID. So I feel like a lot of us are very much going through that.
Yeah.
So you talked about taking about 5 or 6 years to really hone in, get into the animation workshop.
Yes.
How did you go about finding your current internship afterwards? Was it in a listing, or was it recommended by someone there that you should enter?
Oh, it actually was very, very lucky for me. At the animation workshop, they have 1 week of recruitment from other places, where different studios from all over like the world just has some time that they want to spend to recruit interns at the school, because it's so high profile. And I just signed up for a lot of talks and meetings with studios, and by chance, like I signed up for a meeting with Mood Visuals, who wrote me 1 or 2 weeks after my meeting with them that they wanted me to intern there if I would accept it. And that was kind of it. I didn't have to send out any applications at all. It just fell into my lap.
So you said there were people that came from all over the world for that.
Yeah.
May I ask, just what kinds of studios were coming in?
Oh yeah, sure. They didn't come physically because it is a long way to go from different countries. So most of them were doing online calls, but studios like Ubisoft, Mood Visuals, Golden Wolf. I actually think a recruiter from, the ones with stop motion.
Leica?
Yeah, Leica. Yeah, a recruiter came from there too. So it's just been a wide branch of people, like recruiters.
Yeah, lots of different styles too.
Yes. They were not only looking for concept artists. What the animation workshop provides is education is both for animators and, of course, concept artists if you want to do that, visual effects artists, 3D modelers, a wide variety of artists that they're training and educating.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So the recruiters in the company, are these people that this was their kind of main job in the company to recruit others, or is that information that you were not privy to?
I know some of them are not only recruiters. Some of them also have other work that they do next to the recruitment. For example, some people were production managers, others were art directors, so not just recruiters.
What was the interview process like with them? You said it was fairly short that they contacted you afterwards, but was it just kind of simply talking to them a little bit, or?
Yeah, they just schedule half an hour interview with you. Sometimes they have a lot of questions. Other times they're just sitting and listening to what you're saying. But for my specific interview with Mood Visuals, I just showed them around my online portfolio, gave them my link, and then we went through the different pieces that I had, told them a little bit about those pieces, and I tried to be the best person I could be, like my best self. So it was really, really relaxed.
That's wonderful. Well, they clearly saw it. And how long have you been working with them now?
Right now, I've actually been there for 3 months, and I have 3 months left. So I signed up to have a half a year of internship with them.
Probably the question that's asked by all family members at all times is, what are your kind of plans going forward after that?
Oh, that's a really, really tough one. Obviously, it would be really, really wonderful to be hired by them because I really love the work that I do there and the people. It's just a great place in general. But if that's not the case, I will have to do what everybody else does and try to apply for junior concept art position in different places. If it's going to be abroad or in Denmark, I don't know yet. But let's just see how it goes.
Continue the adventure.
Yes.
What were your expectations going into this internship? And thus far in these 3 months, have they matched your expectations? Have they exceeded them?
To be fairly honest, I don't know what expectations I did have because I already knew from the get-go that the style that I do is not something that they do on a regular basis. What they usually do is very realistic, and my portfolio just shows more of a stylistic twist. So I already knew that it was going to be difficult for me to do much. Like, obviously I'm learning like a ton, and I'm so happy that they do pull in some character design works from outside. So I do get a lot of training in character designing for AAA games, which is like really awesome. I couldn't ask for more. But I might have been a bit like insecure about what they could teach me because what they do is very world building stuff. So having them take me in as an intern and being very interested in characters was a little bit of a worry, but I'm so happy that I've gone there because they obviously have taught, like, they knew what I wanted to do from the get-go, from what they saw in my portfolio, and they are just teaching me in what I want to do, and they're doing a great job.
Oh, yeah, and a little bit of a challenge can bring the best education out of someone.
Yes, it's really, really nice that it's so nice when people have a wider skill set, that you're not just doing stylized stuff, that you can adapt to different styles. it helps you see some of the fundamentals in different art styles, like light, figure, space, that kind of stuff, which can be flat in very 2D stuff, but then you have to stand out, like step one, step back, and learn more of the fundamentals and make it more 3D looking in 2D. I don't know if that makes any sense.
Oh, no, I totally get what you're saying.
Okay, good.
So what does your kind of average day look like with them? What days do you have, certain days of the week that you are in office with them? Or I know with COVID, a lot of people were working remote. Was that a thing with the internship? Or
before I got to the internship, the studio did have a lot more of remote work, and they adapted from only sitting in house. But since I've come, there isn't really much of a COVID threat in Denmark. It's been really, really good. So I've actually been to the studio every single house to sit and work and get the feedback in person. It's just a regular 9-to-5 job.
Nice. What would you say is kind of the ratio of meetings / getting to actually draw and things like that?
Oh, what do you mean? Meetings?
So I know that at some jobs there can be a thing of sitting in meetings and discussing kind of plans versus actually getting to sitting down and create art. What would you say is about the ratio, or is that not as much of a thing at Mood?
At Mood, it's only really a thing for the people higher up. For example, I know the directing manager and the art director is always at meetings, or most of the time. And sometimes they pull in their concept artist maybe once a week just to have a check-in. It's really brief. So actually, most of the time you sit and work, it's like 7, sometimes 8 hours of work every day. But it always depends on the deadline and if you make it on time, which is like really nice because everybody at the studio actually makes it on time.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So I take it since people are getting things done in time, there's not as much of that kind of crunch time stress.
No, not really. Like, I've only experienced like a couple of times where I've seen a junior artist have to crunch for maybe 1 or 2 hours over time. But that's not much in comparison to what you can end up sitting and crunching on a longer time period.
Sounds very organized then.
It is. It's really good time management from all the artists that they've hired.
And that's incredibly important, I would say.
Yes.
In any job, really.
Yeah.
So, and thank you for greenlighting these questions beforehand. When it comes to work outside of your internship, if you are offering commissions right now and freelance work, how much do you charge for that sort of thing? And how did you kind of decide on those prices?
I don't do any commissions, but I do work. I really enjoy working on illustrating for books. So that's what I usually do for publishing houses. And for that kind of job, you sit down and get a contract sent to you where everything's outlined, how much you have to deliver, or like how many pages of work or illustrations they want delivered, how long you have to do it within the deadline, and then the price that they want to pay you. Sometimes you can like negotiate on that, but it depends on the publishing house. For me, I've worked both with very educational publishing houses from Greenland, which is, you can't really get paid too much from that because it's very government kind of stuff. So I think for me to do very small illustrations, I did for them maybe 25,000-30,000 crowns for, I think it was 8 or 10 illustrations. But for other places, for more, like for very big illustrations, I did for a proper publishing house, like a real, what do you call it, like 4-page illustrations. I think it must have been like 12 illustrations, double-paged for 50,000 crowns.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then obviously they usually provide you with free copies of the end result.
That's lovely. I feel like it's lovely to be able to hold that in your hand and go like, I made this.
Yes, that is the best feeling ever, really. It's small accomplishments that shines on your shelves.
Mm-hmm. That has to feel nice.
It does.
How long have you been working with publishing companies?
My first experience was before I actually got into the animation workshop. It was like this deal actually also got me into the animation workshop. So I get a lot of really good coincidences sometimes. But this this book is called Bestiarum Grønlandica, which is a creature monster book based on Greenlandic creatures and monsters. Yeah, that's really cool.
I loved books like that when I was little.
Yeah, it's like they're so interesting, but also because I didn't really know much about it beforehand. So it was a big adventure for me just to read through what the creatures looked like and try to kind of design them and illustrate them. It was really a cool job.
So you got paid to have fun in a way.
Yeah, I did.
That's awesome.
But it was also really stressful. Most of the book deals that I've had has been while I've had to go to school too.
Ah, gotcha.
Yeah. So actually, when I worked on Bestiarum Grønlandica, I was going through the education of fashion designing. So I had to juggle those two things at the same time.
That's two very different pieces of subject.
Yeah, very different. It was also like sometimes a big shock whenever going from my school and sitting down in my home studio and sitting to just to reset and do creatures and monsters instead. Like a different mood. I both really loved it, but also it was really tiring and stressful. But I have to say I really enjoyed it.
I can imagine that was also, even through the stress, also a wonderful life experience.
Yes, it was. Also with the other books that I've done alongside being a student at the animation workshop, I've learned a lot about myself and how much I can handle. Though it's really nice to have a lot of work that you've done published, it also got me to a point where I was tired all the time and stressed and just couldn't really handle a lot. So I'm happy that it happened while I was a student, because then I should be able to to not do that while I work, like really work.
You've learned your limits.
I hope so. I'm not sure yet, but like, let's see how it goes further out.
Again, an educational experience in a way.
Yeah.
So jumping back to those questions about prices, did those work well for your kind of cost of living when it comes to things like rent, transit, food? I would say healthcare, but obviously in Denmark, it's very much different than it is here in the States.
Yes. Also, as a Danish student, you do get something called the SU.
Yes.
So you get paid to study, but it's also for a limited amount of years. And I've been really lucky to both marry before starting at the animation workshop, so I had somebody else to help me pay the bills. And when my SU just stopped, because I had been in the education system for too many years, I was really lucky to get the scholarship from creature art teacher just as my SU ran out. So it's just been really lucky again. So that like helped me pay bills for housing, food, and my school. So all the money that I did get paid from making books and illustrations, I've set aside for my company just to sit there, not to really do anything, just as savings. So I haven't really touched them unless like I had to buy a new computer that I could actually work on, which happens sometimes when your computer stops working.
The wonders of technology.
Yes. They can be really tough and surprising.
Yeah.
And inconvenient when they come on the wrong times.
Oh, they can tell. They know.
Yeah.
All right. So we've got a little bit of extra time. So can I ask you some of the extra questions that I sent you as well?
Yes.
Awesome. So before we started recording, we talked a little bit about one of your pieces that did utilize 3D. How do you see it being utilized in concept art?
For the work that I've done with character concept, I haven't used 3D yet. Actually, I've only been using either very 2D draw and painting and photo bashing. So to me, it hasn't been necessary yet to do that, but I do see it very used in the studio in general for either props or environment designing, where you just make a 3D scene and then you paint over it or you photobash over it. So it actually just gets used a lot, actually.
Is it something that you think you'd ever want to dive into?
With my education, I have learned to do 3D. So I can do it, but I would also encourage a lot of people, if they are interested in 3D, to start and learn Blender, because that's becoming more and more of an industry standard in comparison to Maya, which is very expensive.
Yeah, Blender is lovely.
It is, when you know it.
Yes.
I haven't learned it yet, but hopefully I'll get my fingers in it at some point.
I consider it pretty user-friendly.
Yeah.
There are a lot of tutorials for Blender on YouTube, which is very nice. So I personally find Blender a lot more accessible.
It is. And it's just, it's a godsend, really. But when you've learned Maya, it's like the interface is so different from Blender. Obviously, it's the same things they usually... They can almost do the same thing. But the interfaces are so different that it gets confusing.
Mm. The tricky things with technology once again.
Yes.
Semi off topic of 3D, but still concept art related. Are there any non-concept art related experiences that find your way into your creation process? I see a lot of, not similar themes, but related themes in your pieces. Are those brought from life that inspire you, that you bring into your pieces?
If you're talking about the subject of me always drawing on my background, then yes. I do have a very tight connection to my heritage, which is Greenlandic. You could in general call it Inuit. And that's something that I really like. I like to incorporate that in my personal pieces. It's not really something that I can always use when I'm concepting for work or my internship, but I do like it when I sit down and do personal work, because that also makes some, like, it inspires me, it makes me feel, I guess, happier just working with that subject matter, because I haven't really grown up with it as much as a lot of other people, because I've grown up the majority of my life in Denmark, which is detached from Greenland, and all the stories and the culture is not really something that you get taught in Danish school.
I completely understand that. I find myself doing that similarly with my work.
Yeah, and it's always nice to just already know what subject matter that you work within when you're just sitting and relaxing, because then you don't have to like try and grasp for something that you don't really have too much information on.
And it pulls at your heartstrings in a very good way.
Yeah, you learn more.
Mm-hmm. So, is that kind of the main way that you spend your free time off work? Is art always kind of on the brain, or do you have a hobby that is just completely removed from art entirely?
Oh, it's kind of a mix. When I do totally get off the topic of art, I don't know, like maybe this could be up for discussion, but some people find fashion and sewing as being art, but to me it's more detached. Because of my background as a, like, studying fashion design, I do really enjoy to do that while I'm not working or when I just have to do something completely different from drawing. But when I usually don't have my sewing machine with me or I don't feel like sewing, I usually go like sit down and make children books, like just my own stuff that kind of also tries to draw on the Inuit subject. Yeah, that's just, I don't know, for me it's just very fulfilling to sit and work with book illustrations and finally trying to author children books.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, it's really, it's way different from concepting. It's a totally different style and way of approaching a story.
Would that be something that you would potentially want to publish someday, or is that more just, this is just for me to hold in my heart and just have for myself?
Oh no, I really, really enjoy to have things published. And I do get that published. Like it is a different beast from just having a regular concepting art job, because you as an illustrator and ultimately also an author, if you want to do that, you have to sit down and negotiate contracts, and you have to find the publishing houses that fit your style of the story. So it's a totally different beast, and yeah.
That's wonderful. What makes you most excited? We talked about what makes you most excited about your personal projects, but what makes you most excited about concept art?
The ability to just think out ridiculous ideas or nice visuals that ultimately gets like, it gets ideated like so many times, and you get to surprise yourself with the designs you come up with all the time, because you try to dig even deeper than you did the first round and the second round, and going from the first sketch to the very final design, mm-hmm. is just a journey in itself. And when you just lay it out and look at it, you get surprised every time.
Oh yeah.
So I guess that was really makes me excited about concept art, the whole process,
seeing something come to life right before your very eyes.
Yes, and trying to sew in like the stories, the mood, the style, like all the thoughts behind it, because you have to think about so many things while concepting. It's not just because of how cool it looks. It has to have a story, it has to either belong to one group or another. There are just so many things you have to keep in mind while you sit and concept.
So, combining all of these things, I have 1.5 final questions for you.
Yes.
Do you have a goal in mind for your future? What is, besides the obvious love and passion that you have for the craft, what is driving you forward in all of this?
Obviously, the main drive is me being creative, but I think a deeper thing that keeps me motivated and what I really want to do in the future is and it's very personal, because I really, really want to contribute and grow the Inuit culture. And I want to be one of those people who are visible to the world and show and tell more of the Greenlandic perspective or ideas or stories that are in the culture.
That's wonderful. Was there a moment for you when you came to that conclusion, or was it something that was always in your heart that you just kind of always knew?
Yeah, I knew pretty early on, even when I was a kid, that I wanted to do something for my birth country and my heritage. I always thought that I would learn the language when I got older, but I haven't gone to that extent yet. But I always knew that I wanted to do something with Greenland, because there isn't that many people in Greenland. And even though you do have some Greenlandic heritage, it's really hard to get eyes on you, because there are, especially in Denmark, are many stigmas against Inuits. Yeah, I just want to be that positive, bright light for Inuits, and to show that we don't just always make very traditional, like, when I say traditional art in Greenland, it's very often very raw and wild and a bit more caricatured. I haven't really seen other people in Greenland who does very concept-y, illustrated art. Like, well, I guess what I'm trying to say is that I really want to show more clean art coming from a Greenlandic artist.
You want to show a different style and
yes.
that sort of thing.
Yes.
Well, I think that's really beautiful that you want to showcase your heritage. And I think it's really wonderful when people do that, and I love seeing that when, even just when I'm scrolling on Twitter or something, people showcasing their heritage and their art.
Yeah, it's always very admirable. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your time with us and all of your knowledge today. This has been absolutely wonderful.
You're very welcome. I'm so happy that you invited me here and that you even found me. Because it's like, there are so many people out there. It's really hard to stand out sometimes.
Well, as I said, I am a big fan of your work, so...
Thank you.
And I am definitely going to be shouting you out. So while you're here, are there any projects that you're working on that you would like to kind of give a quick little shout out to, or anything of that nature?
I think those would probably be too premature at the moment. Mm-hmm. But I am working on nailing down a book deal where the book is completely done, and then right, like simultaneously I'm working on my next book, like illustration kids book. Yeah.
I'm going to have to look out for that so I can get a copy.
Oh, that would be so nice.
If they don't ship to America, I'll just have to get one of my cousins to send it to me. Problem solved.
Oh, that's so sweet of you. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank everyone so much for listening. If you are a concept artist or know one who might be interested on coming on the show, please let me know. This has been the Concept Artist Podcast. Again, thank you so much, Coco, for coming on today and sharing your time with us. This has been great.
Oh, thank you so much for inviting me. Really, it's been such a nice time just to sit here and talk. It's been so relaxing.
Oh, I'm so glad.
It's actually really nice just to talk with new people too, that you don't see every day or know anything about, and then you get to know them.
I'm so glad. I know I personally am like, I hope that this is a relaxing process and not nerve-wracking or anything like that.
Oh no, it's just, I am naturally very nervous all the time and I keep second-guessing me, which is also like something that I would probably say to aspiring concept artists, especially when you're interning. My best advice would probably be to don't be too hard on yourself, because that's very easy when trying to compare yourself to the people who already work at a studio. I already experienced that a couple of times. You just have to only focus on what you're working on and try to get better. That's probably the only way.
Mm-hmm. And if it helps at all, I was a little nervous because I was excited to talk to you. One, because I admire your art, and two, as a fellow Dane, I was able to relate to a lot of your stories. So I was like, oh, I'm excited.
Yeah. Oh, that's so nice. I really hope to meet you one day, by the way.
I would love that. So nice. Oh my gosh, I would adore that. Yeah. Well, I will let you know the next time I'm able to come back and visit my family.
Oh, that would be so nice. I will like make sure that I could be there, really.
That makes me so happy. I'm smiling from ear to ear. Oh my gosh.
I'd clean out my schedule and just be there to meet you in person.
Oh my gosh, thank you so I'm smiling from ear to ear. Oh my goodness. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You're well, so sweet. You. Oh my gosh. Well, I will not steal any more of your time, but you have been absolutely wonderful.
Well, thank you.
And if you ever want to reach out again or just chat or anything, let me know, because you are wonderful.
And well, thank you. You too. Really.
Thank you so much, and I hope you have a great evening.
Oh, you too. Oh, one last thing.
Yes.
There would be any platforms that I would shout out to. Put in my Instagram there. That's oh, probably
definitely.
The only social media that I really update all the time.
Don't you worry. We got you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, Christina.
No problem. And thank you so much. Again, it's also just nice of hearing someone say my name right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I guess you always hear Kirsten or something, right?
Yeah, Kirsten, or just giving up entirely and saying Christina. And I'm like,
that always hurts.
Yeah. Like, if you squint, I guess.
Yeah, and can't really see what you're reading. Yeah, sure.
Sure. All right.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Have an awesome evening.
Oh yeah, I guess you're having a good morning, right?
Yes, I am.
Great. Okay.
Time zones are fun.
Yeah. Well, have a good morning then.
Well, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.